Hello, Atlanta.
Hello, Atlanta. I have a mic. I'm good. Welcome, welcome, welcome to you from infrastructure administrator to cloud architects. My name is Niki Acosta. I'm a cloud evangelista at Rackspace, and we're thrilled you guys are here today. Is everyone having a good time at the summit? How many of you, is this your first time at the summit? Wow, awesome. So for the past few summits, I've given talks just kind of tracking historically the jobs that are open for OpenStack, and started doing this a few years ago, and we've seen this just huge explosion and tremendous amount of growth in terms of OpenStack careers and the types of companies that are hiring for OpenStack admins and engineers and infrastructure folks and developers. So we're going to talk about that today. I'm really excited to be joined by four awesome panelists. These are a who's who of OpenStack, really. You don't know about that. So I'm going to give these guys an opportunity to introduce themselves. We also have a hashtag that is set up. It is pound OpenStack jobs. And so if you are too shy to answer or to ask a question on a microphone, feel free to tweet it to us, and we will be happy to get to your questions. Before we get started, there's us. I'll come back to this. But many of you may have noticed this job board, and this picture was actually taken early yesterday, and so I think now there's more stuff stacked on top of more stuff, stacked on top of more stuff, but just kind of a good kind of indication of the demand that is out there for OpenStack expertise. And so if we look, this is something that I started tracking a few years ago when we were kind of in that mode of competing along the lines of CloudStack and Eucalyptus. If we look at sort of the job trends for demand in OpenStack, it is just blown up completely. I talked to Nick Barsett of Innovance this morning, great guy. And I said, hey, Nick, I'm doing a talk on kind of jobs in OpenStack. Where are you guys at in terms of hiring? And he said, well, right now we have 10 open positions. Some of those are in France, some of those are in the US. He's like, by the end of this, in the next few months, really, we're going to have probably 50 openings that we're going to need to fill. So you're starting to see, we're kind of seeing the trend moving away from people who are just working on OpenStack to the entire ecosystem. If you saw Troy Toman's keynote, he had the ecosystem slide and defining DevCore. It's not just people who are working to build OpenStack, but now this whole rich ecosystem that covers everything from hardware to software to tools to appliances to storage and network and compute and beyond. So huge demand. I think that's my earrings that's making this noise. Is that my earrings? That's really annoying. I'm gonna have to take those off. So I'm going to let these guys introduce themselves.
We don't have that problem.
I know. That's really frustrating. Why don't we start with you, Aaron, down there on the end.
Sure, absolutely. So hello, everybody. My name is Aaron Delp. I am a cloud solutions architect for SolidFire by day. The nights and weekends job is I also run a podcast on cloud computing and a YouTube channel, thecloudcast.net. And to kind of echo some of those sentiments very quickly of, we talk to a lot of guests in this space, and the number one thing we always talk about either on the podcast or after the podcast is, how can people really get started, and where are the demands? And the number one thing we hear over and over is they're just, you can't find enough people in this space. And so whether it's we're talking OpenStack, whether we're talking DevOps, whether we're talking continuous integration, this trend and this movement, they're simply, the supply and demand is very, very skewed right now. And with that, I'll hand it over to Eric.
I feel bad for Jason, who's going to have nothing left because we're just going to use up the same topics over and over again. My name is Eric Wright. By day, I'm a mild-mannered systems architect for a large financial services firm. And again, we all have evening jobs, and mine is I'm an independent blogger at discoposse.com. And I've been involved in heavily in the VMware community, moved over into OpenStack to work and on the blogging side as well over the course of the last year. Working with some fellow Rackers, we actually run a vBrownBag community, and it's we did a Couch to OpenStack series. And my real focus has been on taking folks and kind of getting them into the 101, 201 level stuff and bringing them on board and understanding what OpenStack is and how it's going to relate against what they're already doing and where they think they're going to be, or whether they think it or not, where they're going to be over the course of the next couple of years. I mean, you folks have probably got the same feeling right now as you may be here with, I'm just reinforcing my learning, or I'm going to start my learning process, or my boss sent me here and I'm not sure why. There's a lot of different levels, but the cool thing is we all are going to walk away with the same idea that we know this, as Aaron said, is a movement. It's a change in the way that things are going. I won't say paradigm shift and all that good architecture stuff, but it really is a change in the way we do things, and it's going to change the way that you do your job and the way that you act in your business day to day. So I'm excited to be here, and thank you very much.
My name is Kenneth Hui. I'm a technology evangelist at Rackspace. Prior to that, I was on the cloud architect team, basically assisting the sales team with talking about OpenStack with customers and then designing actual deployments and implementation. So I've been in the IT industry now for 20-some-odd years, and the closest thing I've seen to this kind of rush to try to find people is probably during the early days of the dot-com era, if you all remember that, and also when Windows NT started breaking into the enterprise, and basically anyone could spell NT would likely to get a job interview. That's the closest analogy I can come to of what things are like right now in the job market today for OpenStack.
Thanks. Hey everyone, I'm Jason Grimm. That's Grimm like fairy tales, not like the Reaper. If you want to email me, it's jason.grimm@rackspace. So like Ken, don't let the boyish charm and dashing good looks fool you. I've been around for 20 or so years. Back naval intelligence, long weird path through telecom and things like that. But the picture that Niki showed that had the the flat line, I'm not sure what that is. So that could say like Jason Grimm's career path. So like years of like not a lot, and then when I found OpenStack, everything kind of changed. I mean, everything became more exciting and more interesting. And as I learned more about OpenStack, there was just doors opening, and I was running into people that were interesting and were doing really interesting things. Like, for instance, some PhD, like astrophysicist doctors that were our customers. I can't mention their name, but I was at the Open Compute Conference last week, and he was saying that I had an intern come to me, or a grad student that was applying, and he got 5 other offers. And we really wanted this guy because he was really hot, and he accepted. And when the doctor asked him, why did you accept? And he said, well, you guys are going to get me hands-on to OpenStack. And that was just a confirmation of what I think, we all know here, is that, it's the hottest growing, fastest growing technology, most disruptive, thing that we can be involved in right now. So
some of you kind of have your roots in VMware, and I imagine a lot of our audience members today also have their roots in VMware. Ken, you're pretty active with the vMug user groups across the nation, it seems. What is that transition like, moving from something like VMware? How is it different? How's OpenStack different?
Yeah, I'll start. So Aaron's actually been involved in VMware probably more longer than I have, but so I think that one big change is VMware is in fact a packaged product, right? So there's a lot of resources there to learn it, but that you don't have to get into as much of the weeds. With OpenStack, the project anyway, there is a lot of pulling pieces together. So you have to be willing to be patient with yourself, because it's not as simple as go walk through a wizard and you've got some OpenStack installed. There's a lot of hand editing of config files that you do with OpenStack that you didn't have to do with VMware. One advice I always give to people, VMware people who want to learn OpenStack, is brush up on your Linux skills. Because there's no way around it. You're going to get on the command line, and you're going to be typing Linux commands. So you have to get used to that idea. And the second thing is, I think in the VMware world, it was very easy to say, hey, the developers or the lines of business said, I want X, so I'm just going to give them X. In the OpenStack world, it has to be much of a collaborative process, because we're exposing all these APIs to the developers, and they have much more control. So it also means that you have to know the application layer much more than you had to do before. So again, if you're someone who are used to just giving out VMs with some storage and saying, I don't even know what application is running on it, you're going to have a problem with OpenStack. You need to know at least a little bit of the architecture behind a web application or a non-relational database, which is what's often run on OpenStack.
Sure, and completely agree. And let me just expand on two points there. From a day-to-day admin standpoint, how do you actually operate this? Ken is spot on. And how do you get those skills up? Yeah, in my mind, you know, it's kind of funny to say and kind of smart to say, but Google is your friend, but I wouldn't even say that. Of SlideShare, YouTube, blogs. In this area of this community-driven project, a lot of people are sharing a lot of great information of what is working for them, and more importantly, what isn't working for them at times. And so Ken has a great blog. Cody Bunch, who is a Racker, has written some books on this. I mean, there's a lot of great resources out there on the how to get low-level and operate this. Now, the second point, though, is you have to also think higher level. When we talk about virtualization and the shift that happened there, your thinking from an architecture standpoint didn't have to change. All you were doing was taking something from a physical environment and moving it to a virtual environment. The applications looked the same, ran the same. You just took it from here and plopped it there. What we're talking about here is a very different architecture of how things are really modeled, the applications, the way they look, how they are deployed through, you know, the thoughts of DevOps and continuous integration. There's actually much more to the architecture of cloud management than there was in the virtualization thing. So there's really kind of two fundamental. One, very low level, how do I get up to speed? And secondly, how does the architecture change and what does that mean of matching an application to the management platform?
You want to add to that?
I'll add just same sort of thing. Again, coming out of the traditional VMware camp, I was lucky I worked with Linux early, mostly because nobody else wanted to, and I thought that's whenever I would see something that people were afraid of, I thought that was a good place to try, because you've got to understand, you know, what it is that they're afraid of, and luckily it worked out that it wasn't as difficult as most people thought, and my whole goal was to learn it so that I could share that journey and get other people down the road and make them more comfortable. You know, again, Ken says, this isn't wizard-driven, this is not next, deploy. You know, there's a lot more involvement. The generalist is now a real win because you need to have an understanding of the broad base of the security, storage, you know, network, application layers. It's good to expand your knowledge. So whereas we used to be told you've got to become specialists, but a specialist is now a very broad thing. You're a specialist in an ecosystem, which ultimately means you're a generalist. So it's a good time to, you know, get out there and experience different things. And again, the community is massive on this, not just on writing and contributing to this project, but to actually contributing to the training and sharing of information and getting other people involved to help them along. And, you know, whether it's, you know, OpenStack as it is now, or stuff that's come up to this point, or what's coming next, it's out there, and everybody has that same level of access, and that's a really phenomenal thing.
And I'll just add a couple of quick things regarding VMware that I have conversations, and they were uncomfortable for me for a while because a lot of times the answer was no or it doesn't exist, and someone would say, this is how I do this today in VMware. Show me how you do it. You know, where's this function and where's this feature? And, you know, I was so excited. I wanted to squeeze OpenStack into every, you know, square hole I could make it fit. And there's not an easy answer a lot of times. And those things are philosophically and fundamentally different. It took me a while to get my head around that. You know, it's built different. It's the use case is different. It's better. It's more utility based. But as some of these guys were saying, you know, transformatively and fundamentally and philosophically, it's different. So you kind of have to understand that piece, and then down under the hood from learning the bits, I found early on that DevStack not only will give you an environment to play in, but if you look down into one of the folders, there's actually exercises to walk through, and that it'd take the environment that was just built and do things with it. And actually, there's ways to run and break the environment and force you randomly and force you to go and fix the environment. So it's like, it's not just your sandbox. There's actually some learning tools within DevStack, which if you haven't used it yet, it's like two commands to get a whole OpenStack environment running. If you want to get your hands dirty, that is the least, your quickest path to go.
So you guys mentioned a few things that I want to kind of dig into a little bit more. As I kind of looked this morning, I did a little bit of research, was looking at the positions that were open within the OpenStack community and ecosystem, and I looked at the ones from a year ago. And so a year ago, it was very much Python developers, it was infrastructure specialists, it was architects. Now, if I look today, we're starting to see that it's software engineer or DevOps engineer or software architects. Are you all seeing that similar shift of expertise moving up the stack? And if so, how are you gaining the skills to move sort of, or to at least be aware and familiar with the expertise needed to go above the infrastructure layer into the software layer?
Well, I think it's absolutely true. You know, just in the way that the maturity of the whole ecosystem is pushing stuff up, you don't need to be a hardcore Python coder to be able to get in there. It's not necessary anymore. It's good to have an understanding of it. Like you have to have a comfort with the command line. You know, people always look at my desktop at work and they say it looks like the Matrix all the time. Like everybody else is, I'm supporting a lot of Windows systems. Why does it always look like that? Well, that's because I know there's different things that I'm looking at, and that's the level that I go to. But I'm not a developer. I'm not a agile project manager, I'm not a DevOps guru, but I understand what all of it is and how it interacts so that I can interact with the other teams that are actively doing that. And that's the change in the roles, that we're no longer needing everybody to be a software developer that can carve off Python like it's a second language. But these are people that can just understand what Python is and how it's being used by the team of larger communities of developers now, and how it's going to come in. DevOps obviously is a big movement. You know, number one, read the Phoenix projects. You know, start there, work your way up. Again, you don't have to be actively deploying full DevOps infrastructure, but understand what it is. And that's the change that, you know, the role is now knowing the ecosystem instead of actively being a part of it.
Now, one of the interesting things I've been seeing is there was a time, I think, maybe a year ago even, kind of like you were pointing out, where when I talked to customers, they thought of OpenStack as a free version of VMware. And so they were thinking, I would just take the same process and people that I was using before with VMware, and I'll port it over and use it with OpenStack. And we spent a lot of time trying to educate people on that, how that's not the way things should be done. And I'm starting to see that change this year, where almost every discussion I have about cloud computing and OpenStack, it's generally paired with this concept, sort of, well, I guess you call it DevOps, where they're saying we also want to change the way we operate a cloud. We want to change the way people work with developers. We want to be more agile and use, you know, different tooling than they traditionally use. So I think that's what's driving those types of new job requests is that if you are a traditional infrastructure admin today, maybe doing VMware or Hyper-V or Windows, there's a new set of skills now that you need to learn, and it doesn't always it's not all technology either. It isn't just learning OpenStack and you can become an OpenStack architect. You have to actually learn skills like how to talk with developers, and how to work collaboratively. Yeah, if you guys don't know what Jenkins is, you need to learn what Jenkins is, because it's going to come up in your as you make that transition to do cloud computing.
I'll just add something real quick, because you guys actually took all the good answers. So the only other thing I would add is absolutely in this shift in OpenStack as a project over time, we spent a lot of time, I would say, you know, in Portland last year, there was really a lot of how do you get the underlying components to actually functionally work? And it was almost like a red light, green light kind of thing of, does it work, does it not work, is it functional, yes or no? And I think we've moved beyond that to the point where it isn't does it work or not, because it does, it's more of, is it a car that goes 20 miles an hour or is it a NASCAR that does 200 miles an hour, right? I'm in Atlanta, so I got to pull in a NASCAR analogy at some point. And so it's really how fast can you go and how well can you tweak and tune? And I think that's where the jobs are really starting to be more of how do I operate this and how do I operate this efficiently, as opposed to how do I just get this working and out of the garage.
And the, look, I mean, you look outside, there are a ton of vendors here. I mean, I think one of the things that I hear more than anything else is like, people who go and start to explore OpenStack, again, it is not a product, and people want to think of it that way. But now you have plugins for everything. You have optimized hardware for things. You have the option to go DIY, or you can use a vendor. How do you wrap your head around all the various plugins and everything that's going on with every project? And how do you make the decision to either go DIY or outsource it to a vendor or leverage some expertise elsewhere?
Let's take it first. We'll let Jason go first because we always cut him off.
Yeah, Jason goes first this time.
That just kind of blew my mind because I was thinking about the response to the last question. But I guess they kind of tie in together. So looking at OpenStack, it's funny because it's going up the stack, and to your last question, it's also going down the stack. If you look at projects like LBAS and L3 and Firewall as a Service and VPN as a Service going up, and the OpenStack controlling more of that, and from the downside, ironic, and more bare metal and more vendor drivers giving OpenStack yet more control over the infrastructure and over that hardware. It's almost like a, you know, pinky in the brain, you know, OpenStack is going to take over the world and your whole data center. But it's from a project selection standpoint, I think the dividing factor is if there's a vendor bundled distribution or supported release of OpenStack, we'll say, and that meets all of your needs, then it might be something to consider more strongly. If you have things, you know, other projects that may be an incubation or an integration, or you have some very specific needs in the way you need to deploy that, a lot of times, you know, you're in an area where a do-it-yourself, you know, solution might work better. Now, the DIY is tough because you've got to ramp up your technical bench to support that. And as we've been saying, it's not just Linux, you know, it's not just network, it's not just this or that, it's a whole philosophy, and you got to know the apps as well. So, to me, the break point on, you know, which do you do it yourself or do you look at a vendor solution, comes to understanding your technical requirements very closely, and then deciding what you can or cannot live with in a prescriptive solution.
And I'll just add too. Again, for me, the some of those routes. Actually, it's the bigger architecture kind of thing of again, assessing the workloads that you have in your environment both today and in the future, and figuring out which of these potential architectures can fit to that, or projects or products. And it's really about where you are coming from in a background, right? So I did bare metal hardware, you know, servers and storage, and then I moved on to virtualization, and then eventually into converged infrastructure, and then from converged infrastructure to really cloud management. And what I did, though, is in this transition, you always want to be outside of your comfort zone so that you're always moving and learning and embracing these new technologies that are moving our industry forward. But at the same time, you don't want to be so far out of your comfort zone that you're completely lost. And that can absolutely happen. And especially in the do-it-yourself route, you know, I completely admit there's no way I should be anywhere near Neutron at this point. Right? There are certain projects that are good for me, and there are certain projects that are bad for me, right? And so that is an area where, again, you have to assess your bench staff, you have to assess the products that are out there, as well as your architectures, and kind of wrap it all together. And there is no right answer. There is no silver bullet. It is going to be whatever is unique for your situation based off of your workloads, your staff, and what you have available.
I saw a t-shirt, actually. Many of you may have seen this during the conference, but someone has a t-shirt and it says Nova Network, and then it says Quantum, and then it
Neutron.
Says Neutron, and then it says Nova Network, and all the other three are crossed out. So it just kind of goes to show there's some there's some competing thoughts there when it comes to networking just as a whole, and I think it's one of those projects that people are really struggling with because it's so fundamentally different than the way that people have been operating for so long.
So to the question you had earlier, I'll take it in a little slightly different direction, is that I think because the OpenStack project is evolving so quickly, I think the skill sets that you need, that people are looking for, are evolving just as quickly. So I think There was a time where there was a value in someone being able to configure RabbitMQ and set up the MySQL database. I think now, though, we're starting to move into a point where your ability, although you still need to know Linux skills, because you still need to know kind of at the core how things work, I think we're starting to get to the point where there's a lot more value as there are more projects coming into OpenStack. There needs to be people who see the whole big picture, who can make that decision for their employers to say, what pieces within OpenStack should I be using, and how should I put it together? So I think someone did a study, and there were like 500 potential configurations for deploying OpenStack today. And that's only growing as we add more services to it. So who is the person who can take the business and application requirements from their employees and say, this is the configuration that will that is optimized for this particular requirement? And I think if you can do that, then you become invaluable to your employer and invaluable to other potential employers.
How many of you have spare time? Nobody, right? So there's probably a lot of folks that are sitting around going, okay, this sounds great, OpenStack, learning it, blogs, trainings, which a lot of vendors host. How do you make the case to your leadership teams to allow you to go and get those new skills or sponsor the idea to perhaps send people to chef or puppet training or something like that? How do you convince the people above you that it's the right thing to do for your business?
There's a real change I find personally in the way that a lot of this happens is that as architects, whether it's systems architects or you're moving towards cloud architect or whatever your role is, no matter what level you're at, we have to do a lot more to just show it's already happening. It was the old classic thing, it's easier to get forgiveness than permission. You've kind of got to be running the stuff, you know, even on your own time a little bit. And I know no one has free time. But we have enough free time that this is your future. You know, we took 5 years out to go to university, or 6 years, or no years, you know, in some cases, whatever it is. But we took that time out to educate ourselves in a different way. And employers have a different, you know, view on it because, of course, there's more and more training opportunities out there, but they're also growing in cost. And if you're going to train towards something that they aren't using already, it's a tough justification. So that's why we kind of have to be a little bit more self-directed. And again, because of the depth and the width of this community, there's so many great resources you can get with a limited amount of time, you know, like SlideShare, YouTubes, watch the OpenStack Summit presentations from last year. You're going to see these. They're going to be online soon after we do them, you know, this week. So there's quick ways that you can get it. Podcasts. You know, listen in your car. You know, you're walking your kids to the beach. You can, you know, listen in one ear while you're watching them play out in the sand. We have to kind of take it unto ourselves to get ahead of it. And at that point, we can pitch the case better to what our management teams, because they want to hear what's my value prop? What am I going to get by sending you on either $5,000 of training or letting you go for 4 hours a day for 3 days and figure it out yourself? We've got to create that value prop and show that we can prove it out.
So I've got a little secret for all of you in the audience. Every one of your employers, whoever you're working for, they are looking at OpenStack. So the question isn't really, I think the question isn't, hey, is my employer thinking about OpenStack and how do I get them to do that so I can get training? I think it's up to you to find out which organization within your company is looking at OpenStack and then saying, hey, I've actually started learning this, so I want to be involved because I can help us deploy it more quickly.
And I was just going to add, the number one thing I found is find a point project. Find that one use case or that one application or that one project in your organization that looks new, looks shiny, and looks like it could be a good fit for this, and then get yourself attached to it. And that is the value of learning as we go today is completely necessary, especially in this industry of everything moving so fast. A lot of the building the plane while we're flying it happens all the time. And that is the biggest thing I've seen as a motivator for organizations of, I need to get to that goal. How are we going to get there? We'll figure it out as we go.
So that question of how to upsell it internally, is a conversation a couple of weeks ago, and it's been stuck in my head ever since. And we're at an impasse in the conversation where we were very passionately speaking with this other company about OpenStack, and you know, all the value proposition, and the DevOps and the time to deployment and all of this. And we got to the end of the conversation, and the response was, well, that's great, but you know, so what? It takes me 90 days to deploy a bare metal today and 30 days to do a VM, and it costs 10 times as much, but you know, so what? And we were all, you know, everyone around was kind of, there's like 100 answers, but it becomes a religious debate at that point. And one of the guys looked at him and said, because if you don't, you're going to fail. And he said, then there's another pregnant silence after that. And he went on to say, your competitors are doing it. And if you don't, if you don't get into it, or at least look at it, or start going down that road, very honestly, if everybody else is, you know, you're going to be selling encyclopedias here before too long. So my response when I'm trying to upsell something is, if you don't, you're going to fail. I would agree with Ken that if they're not deploying it, they are earnestly looking at it. We're in this industry now, and everyone in this room has come up to something that has amazing groundswell. I've heard the phrase more disruptive to the market than the mainframe, to wireless technology or to virtualization or any of those. It truly is. So that if you just go and upsell that and you just have that passion, well, just look them in the eyes and tell them they're going to fail if they don't do what you want them to do. So.
You look like you just had a light bulb go off.
Yeah, just one thing, and that's a great on what Jason said, what all of us have said. It's going to come, and the difference is whether you get ahead of it and you pitch it to your management team, or whether they come and they tell you that they've already hired a consultant that's going to do it and potentially put you aside in what you're doing. You know, you've got to take an active part in pushing this forward. As Ken says, it's already out there. We think that we're ahead of it. It's like when they announce a merger. It didn't get figured out yesterday. They've been working on it for 18 months. OpenStack isn't going to just land tomorrow. They've already been looking at it. So you have a responsibility for yourself and for the growth of your organization to get ahead of it and get involved.
So we talk a lot about the need for OpenStack, but I think one thing that might be hot on the minds of people are, what are people actually using it for? You know, obviously you guys work for different companies, you have different perspectives. What are the use cases where you're seeing that OpenStack is gaining the most traction? You want to start with Aaron over there?
Sure. So the biggest use case I'm seeing right now is absolutely that kind of test dev environment internally, that QA testing of, I need to spin something up, and I need to spin it up in an orchestrated, automated way where it is the same every single time. I only use it for a short amount of time, and I throw it back down. I just, you know, that dynamic pools of resources, I check them out, I use them, I check them back in. That is far and away the biggest one I'm seeing right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's the number one thing is, if you don't have a use case for anything, there's no point in even looking at it. The use case is number one. If it's not answering a question of why, then it's not going to get you anywhere. Like, my use cases that I see is, because I'm in financial services and I work with a lot of folks that are in that space, private cloud is a number one reason why people are looking at OpenStack, from my perspective, because it's an option for them to completely grow their internal data centers, turn them into private clouds, potentially consume public services in the same ecosystem. So again, it's because, you know, that comfort, it's inside, it's outside. That's where it's going to be. So that's a great use case that I found for it.
So again, in Rackspace, what we see is test dev as the number one current deployment use case. But in terms of what's driving OpenStack adoption, it's usually one of two things. One is, my developers are using AWS already, or Rackspace Public Cloud, and I've been told I have to give them the same experience in-house. So that's a driver. And then the second driver is, I'm talking to more and more large companies where they're developing next-gen applications, web-scale, mobile-type of applications, and what they're telling me is, the way they were doing things, the technology they used to use, whether it's, again, it's Windows or VMware, can't scale fast enough to meet their needs. And the only way they can do this is to use OpenStack with some hypervisors that can.
Brother Grimm?
Sure. So use cases. So I use OpenStack to mine Bitcoin mostly. no, I'm kidding. Now, the most successful use cases that I've seen and deployed and designed are use cases where you can, the guest operating system or the VM or the instance or the image, depending on whatever you call it, is as agnostic as possible, meaning you care as little about it as possible. So your horizontally scaled web and app tiers, your Nginx's and Apaches and Tomcats and things like that, the best use case, it's kind of an overused word, I guess, but the best way I see that deployed is when you can have those spin up and spin down dynamically, and if they get sick, you know, you don't care about DRS anymore at that point, because it would take longer to figure out where the machine is and to move it here or to back it up or restore it versus just, you know, in 3 minutes you can have one more or 10 more or 50 more. So the entry point into your company and into your apps and services are those thin horizontally scaled Linux-based apps, right? You can put, you know, a Windows SQL clustered box on OpenStack, but you can also drive with your feet, you know. and I stole that from someone else too, but just because you can do it doesn't mean you should, right? So short of it is go for those web and app horizontal scaled workloads.
All right, we have like a minute left. Does anyone have a question? Yes, sir. I think we have time for one. By the way, you can tweet us at pound or hashtag OpenStackJobs, and if we don't get to your questions here, we'll answer them afterwards. Yes, sir.
Yes, could you maybe give us a parallel? We look at enterprise architect as a definition. We look at application architects as a definition. Could you kind of give us a quick summary of how you perceive the architect definition between the business side and the application side? I think there's a gap there, and I was curious what you thought.
Who wants to take that? It's a great question.
I'll take the first shot at it. so I completely agree. And the way I look at it is when it comes to, because I have a background in consulting, of that idea of analyzing exactly what the business needs are first, and then taking them and roll, they determine the application results, and then that determines the infrastructure needs, et cetera. You know, it kind of all rolls downhill, but it always, always, always starts with how do you serve the lines of business best?
Whether it's to save money or move faster,
exactly,
get products to market faster,
exactly,
or prevent people from going rogue, right?
Yes. Exactly.
Thank you, thank you, thank you all for being here. Again, if you want to tweet us, all of us are active on Twitter. You can also hashtag OpenStack Jobs, and we will be happy to answer your questions. Enjoy the rest of your summit. Thank you.